Welcome back to Capital Today. You're rejoining me, Ben Ibrahim, and Tan Sri Datuk Dr. Yusof Basiron, who is the CEO of the Malaysian Palm Oil Council. And he's given us a very insightful view indeed, about the Malaysian palm oil industry, the internal and external success stories and challenges, which is what business is all about. Tan Sri, thank you very much for being with us once again. You shared with us some very interesting insights into this industry which has many perceptions, as you alluded to much, much earlier. But Tan Sri, moving forward in terms of this discussion, can you tell us in very layman's terms about the RSPO, which is an international governing body of the industry?
The RSPO was an NGO initiative to introduce certification scheme for sustainably produced palm oil. And they have developed various criteria and standards detailing out how production of palm oil should be carried out in order to qualify for being certified as sustainably produced palm oil, for the palm oil that is being produced. So by promoting this scheme, they have attracted members from the producers, Malaysia, Indonesia, traders, bankers, NGOs, and all those who are linked to the palm oil supply and trading chain. And having members, therefore, makes this whole RSPO as a fairly significant body to encourage their so-called initiative to be adopted by the producers of palm oil here in Malaysia, Indonesia. Mm-hmm. Problem is, the initial intention was very noble, that if you can show and prove through certification that your palm oil is produced sustainably,
right,
then buyers in Europe would have no problem in buying this and consuming this certified palm oil. Problem is, being an NGO initiative, the RSPO keeps on changing their rules and regulations.
Yeah.
And this rule changing happen to be done on a vote basis, in which the producers are no longer a commanding voice in the voting process. So more and more the producers feel left out in the voting system and rule making system, because they are minority in terms of voting power.
If I'm hearing you correctly,
so
there's a
it becomes an unfair scheme that the producers are feeling not worth pursuing, and some, like the Malaysian Palm Oil Association, are thinking they are thinking
that was my next question.
You know,
I hear a little bit of frustration
and
like, hence the word unfair. Is that why the Malaysian Palm Oil Association is thinking of, well, divorcing itself from this international body?
Yeah, when the original objective and the original intentions are no longer fulfilled and being hijacked more and more by NGOs, you know, to suit their own agenda, and more or less having a claim and control over the palm oil supply process, that would disadvantage the producers.
Right.
And therefore, that is one possible reason why the MPOA, Malaysian Palm Oil Association, wants to withdraw. The Indonesian Palm Oil Association has withdrawn from membership a few years ago, so for the same reason. And in Indonesia, they replace their own version of the sustainability scheme called ISPO,
right,
Indonesian Sustainable Palm Oil.
Mm-hmm.
Malaysia is thinking similarly with a Malaysian version called MSPO. So, but this is not yet introduced. But when it is introduced, perhaps MPOA may actually want to withdraw from RSPO and support MSPO instead.
Right.
So this is like the politics of the...
The politics. Well, no industry is perfect.
Of the palm oil trade.
No industry is perfect, Tan Sri. But if I hear you correctly, what you're telling our viewers about the industry, because this segment is very much about education of certain industries and no different here today with the Malaysian palm oil industry, its internal and external challenges and success stories. But if I hear you correctly, especially from our discussion this morning, a lot of your challenges come from the NGO front. Now, what, in summary, in just in pure summary, what are the NGOs wanting in terms of the running of this industry? Because like you said, they have their own views, but it comes across as extremely strong, and in this case, extremely influential. So in summary, what is their main objective and goal?
The NGOs are anti-deforestation. They don't want deforestation. They think that as environmental NGOs, they should keep forests as forests and not be cut to be converted to agriculture, land, and so on. And palm oil becomes an easy target because Malaysia, Indonesia, every inch of our land is or was originally forest.
Yes.
And
so they're talking about deforestation.
Every
issues,
time we develop agriculture, it has to be a case of deforestation. But the West, the developed countries have developed and their land deforested long time ago. So they don't see deforestation taking place anymore.
Right.
But we are a developing country. We have not developed yet.
Right.
And we still need to deforest land that has been designated as agriculture land.
Right.
We have to remove the trees because this is for agriculture, not for forest. At the same time, we are quite contented that we have conserved our forest by committing to keep half of our land area as permanent forest.
Right.
So there is no issue for us about deforestation because the forest that we want to have as forest is still forest. But the one that we want to develop as agriculture should be allowed to be developed as agriculture.
Right.
But because of these different, let's say, phases of development, the developed country NGOs think that all over the world there should be no more deforestation because they have developed and we should not develop our forests.
When you say developed countries of the NGOs, are you talking more from Europe and North America? Or
yes, I think the Japanese also are developed. Is also a they are also a developed country.
Oh, very much so. Yes.
Very much, but they do not and they do not let's say follow the approach taken by the EU or Europe and US. They understand the need of the developing countries to develop. So that need is a sovereign right, meaning nobody should stop us from developing.
Right.
And so they monitor this well and cooperate with us how to develop sustainably.
Right.
Whereas Europe and US, they use their NGOs to impose their will against development and not to cut any more forests. Simply perhaps as a strategy, because the main source of deforestation is by their cattle industry. And their soybean and sugarcane industry, their own industry is still deforesting. But to camouflage all these deforesting activities, they use their NGOs to kind of campaign against deforestation, focusing on palm. And therefore, you know, this is buying time for them that they can continue to deforest even much, much more than Malaysia or Indonesia put together.
Right,
because this is their bread and butter. They need to depend on agriculture. They need to depend on beef, on cattle production in order to survive the economy.
Right.
So we are therefore seeing some unfair and double standards being imposed.
Of course.
We are not yet developed and yet we are preventing from developing.
And being attacked at the same time.
And being demonized for no good reason.
Yeah, exactly.
If they want forests, we have more than enough forests,
yes,
you
that's
know.
Right.
So, yeah. This is the dilemma of a developing country trying to beat you know, the marketplace.
That's right.
Yeah,
let's talk
commodity.
About that dilemma. Now, when these, just give us a bit of an example, that when these NGOs come at you strong, they want A, B, C, and D, and like you said, it's in relation to deforestation, how does countries like Indonesia and Malaysia would sell it to them and, well, rebut their views and arguments? Because at the end of the day, I mean, if you look at the simple economics of this, okay, if you say to them, look, okay, we understand where you're coming from, deforestation, not very good for the environment, all of the above. However, we as an economy, we need to progress. We need to give people jobs.
We need
to make sure our numbers are good so we can move forward. How do you sell it to them? Is that the way you sell it to them, or is there another way?
Well, the government is always providing this basic information about how we produce our palm oil, how we run our forests, mm-hmm. how we run our country. We are good citizens of the world. We are not out there to destroy the environment and so on.
Sure, we're not.
So these messages, we broadcast to governments, to the West, and so on and so forth. But the issue is, the West now, they employ the NGOs as part of their civil society scheme. And the NGOs are funded by the Western government. So they get a lot of funds. And what do they do with the funds? They start looking for issues to promote, to their advantage.
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose if they reduce production of palm oil through all this anti-palm oil campaign, there would be more room for the Western countries to produce their own oils and market their own oils. In other words, improving their competitive stance by using their so-called NGO agents to kind of diminish the competitiveness of competing oils like palm.
That's
so
right.
This is, to me, although a strategy that can legally be adopted, but it's also an unfair, sometimes even brutal strategy.
Preventing
produce of farmers from reaching markets in France or in Europe. So that is not fair. It's not something that they commit in terms of world trade commitment, where trading market access would be facilitated.
Right.
Rather, this is just the opposite, trying to prevent market access.
Yeah. Now, Tatsri, let's talk about the ecosystem of the industry, because at the end of the day, what you're trying to do and your colleagues are trying to do is create that valuable ecosystem which is always developing for the better, regardless of challenges. Yeah. Now, in terms of the ecosystem, one trend that I notice is that many investors, some investors in Malaysia are investing in Indonesian palm oil rather than Malaysian palm oil resources. Your comments on that?
Well, we are good at producing palm oil with our technology and experience. And we are not a big country, therefore limited land for agriculture, because we have to keep a lot of our land under forest. So in that sense, we have to look for countries that can offer the right availability of land and labor. Mm-hmm. And climate, of course. And Indonesia
LLC,
is
land, labor, and climate. Very easy to remember, yeah?
Yeah, so Indonesia is one of the opportunities for us to invest in and produce palm together with them.
Yeah.
Why not? And they have a lot of land, a lot of labor. As long as we do it within the legal
framework
provisions of a country and abiding by some, let's say, sustainability criteria, this should be promoted, because the world is in need of this oil.
Of course, but wouldn't, on the flip side, wouldn't some people be saying, decision makers within the industry, internally in Malaysia, said, hey, what's going on there, you're supporting Indonesia, shouldn't you be supporting the internal front, I mean, there is always that element of that,
Yeah, but this is a borderless world in terms of, business.
Okay.
When we do business, it is with a view to enhance the business opportunity as well as the growth of the own country, where we do business.
So okay, growth first.
It is always mutually beneficial.
Mutually beneficial.
Otherwise, it won't work.
Now, speaking of making it work, is there, because Malaysia and Indonesia are the two biggest countries in this market, now, is there a quota in terms of export quota that countries abide by, that how much they can export to a certain country? Is there any form of control in that matter?
No. We know the market is short of oil. From year to year, we have to produce 6 million tons more oils right. and fats.
Right.
The Western countries, other countries cannot produce as much, not even half, not even one third of that, you know, regularly. 6 million tons of new oil for them would require 60, or let's say 60 million hectares of land. Right. That is not possible.
Right.
And it is only possible if we combine with the effort from palm.
Okay.
So there is no quota necessary to be arranged.
Okay.
But of course, during a period of depressed prices, we have our biodiesel market to turn to to consume more oil to remove excess stock.
Because the reason I asked that question, because in the year 2011, Indonesia changed its export quotas, and that affected how some of the Malaysian companies did their business and sort of achieved their results and whatnot. So that was the reason I was asking. But what was the main learning curve from that decision by our Indonesian counterparts in 2011?
Well, if you try to play the market to your own advantage without considering the partner, like
they
Malaysia,
consult?
Of course they consult, but mainly for their advantage of encouraging downstream processing. What happened is the market price will come down.
Of course.
And both countries will lose a lot of export revenue in terms of value because prices have come down to a much lower level compared to the previous time.
Right.
So the lesson is, if you try to play the market without considering the overall picture, you tend to lose value, and both will lose. It's a lose-lose strategy.
It's a lose-lose strategy.
So now what we do is, we say Indonesia will ensure palm oil is never in much excess by having their own biodiesel industry develop. I think they're talking about B10, blending 10%. We're talking about B5, B7, blending 5 or 7%. So this will remove that potential excess supply, and therefore create a improved price situation again.
Right.
So that's what has happened. So what we learn is that we should not, you know, play the game alone. We have to
take into account that's a very good point. You've taken the words right out of my mouth. Not playing the game alone, because nothing is forever. Now you said this industry needs a very good climate. Now you look at other Southeast Asian countries like your Myanmar's, your and others, Thailand's of this of the region. You know, they've got the climate to do it. They've also got more manpower to do it in terms of people. Like, can you see them sort of catching up with Malaysia and Indonesia in the very near future?
Sorry, they don't have the climate.
Yeah.
They have a long period of drought within a year, 2-3 months, and this will affect their oil palm yield.
Right.
And therefore, they would not be as competitive.
But surely, I mean, that's something that they can look at, no?
Well, if they want to irrigate, they have a river, but sometimes the rivers also dry up during the drought period.
Which country specifically?
All the countries outside Malaysia and Indonesia, they are subjected to drought.
Right.
The countries are not, let's say, misinformed. They know what they can and could not do.
Of course. So they are aware of that situation.
Yeah, so they're aware, and therefore history has told us that these countries don't have palm oil, and this is because they don't have the climate.
Okay. Okay. So they don't have the climate. Okay, that's another myth out there.
Yes.
Now, just coming towards the end of a very interesting and insightful and informative interview, and we thank you very much for that. But moving forward, what can we expect from the industry in terms of changes, developments, and just moving forward, really?
Well, the industry is trying to become more and more efficient. You know, there are many smallholders there that are small in size, and if we can improve the size
factor,
factor itself, that will help all our smallholders to earn a target income of 4,000 ringgits per month, for example, which is what is desired when we reach a status of a developed country by 2020. So some kind of a reform of land size for the small players may be necessary going into the future.
Right.
But as far as palm oil is concerned, we are only touching the tip of the iceberg, as they say, because there are so many valuable products to be tapped, to be harnessed, to be commercialized from the palm oil industry. the biomass is in plentiful supply, right now is not commercially utilized properly to add value to this industry. The biomass industry alone could probably double the revenue of this industry
wow.
into the future.
Okay. Okay.
The new the minor components like the vitamin E, the vitamin A, research have shown them to be highly, let's say, valuable minor components, which again can have a very high value when commercialized, that it will add 20-50% more revenue on top of what the palm oil industry is already enjoying.
Right.
So I think we have to be patient and yet work hard to focus to develop all these opportunities from an industry that is already there, you
right.
know.
Right.
So this is what I call a blessed industry.
Right.
All we have to do is tune in our brain power to make it work even better for us.
Well, patience is never a key attribute that many entrepreneurs have, but it's all about living and learning. And definitely, Tan Sri, we have learned a lot about the palm oil industry, not just the Malaysian palm oil industry, but the global palm oil industry. And on behalf of Capital Today, we'd like to thank you very much for coming in and giving us and making a very technical topic look extremely simple, something that not many people can do. And thank you very much again, Tan Sri. That's right, everybody, we've spoken to Tan Sri Datuk Dr. Yusof, who is the CEO of the Malaysian Palm Oil Council, talking about the industry's internal and external challenges, and definitely success stories, and definitely how is the best forward to move forward in this industry. We're just gonna take a very short commercial break, but don't go away. More news coming your way right here on Capital Today.